I would like to deal in today's broadcast with the subject of deliverance, deliverance from satanic oppression and the powers of darkness. Now, this happens to be a ministry that the Lord gave us many years ago. We've dealt with hundreds and hundreds of people on this subject. We've prayed for many hundreds of people for deliverance, and we have been several years in the deliverance ministry. And I want to deal today with one of the misconceptions that a lot of Christians have concerning whether or not a Christian can be oppressed by the powers of darkness. Satan has many Christians deluded concerning this question: can a Christian be oppressed by Satan? Well, the Bible shows believers can be oppressed, vexed, depressed, hindered, bound, and afflicted by Satan, or even suffer infestation by demonic spirits at times. We are to make a distinction, however, between demon possession, in which the life and will is under the dominion and control of Satan, and invasion of the mind or body by malevolent spirits, such as, for example, spirits of infirmity, spirits of fear, resentment, doubt, depression, and such like. Now, it's in the latter condition that we have reference to when we speak of a Christian suffering infestation by evil spirits, not to demon possession per se, as may be seen, for example, in the account of the Gadarene demoniac in Mark chapter 5. However, I found in my ministry of deliverance that malignant spirits can invade the mind and body of a Christian and must be cast out before deliverance from their problems, which these spirits cause, can be realized. Then we must say that in such cases, an individual is oppressed by Satan or infested with an evil spirit to which they've yielded for one reason or another. Now, one may sit in his ivory tower, his theological tower, and debate the possibility of this fact at length. But just one or two encounters with the reality of the powers of darkness in the lives of Christians today can do much in the way of correcting one's theology on this matter, I found out. Now, I know from personal experience in my deliverance ministry that believers can be oppressed and suffer invasion of the mind and body by malicious spirits, for the precise reason that most of those that I've dealt with for deliverance have been Christians, and some of these have been spirit-filled Christians, by their participation, for example, in some form of occultism, playing with the Ouija board, visiting a fortune teller, subjecting themselves to hypnosis and so on, reading astrology. They've found they've opened a door to oppression or invasion by the powers of darkness, and therefore they need deliverance from this oppression. The fact that believers can be oppressed by demonic spirits is seen in several instances in the scriptures themselves. The oppressing misfortunes and physical affliction of Job are clearly said to be the work of Satan. You read Job chapters 1 and 2, and you'll see the devil is responsible for oppressing this believer. Even in the house of God, there can be those possessed with unclean spirits, as Mark 1:23 and following clearly teaches. We read, "And there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit whom Jesus set free." He was a member of that synagogue. And there's no reason to doubt that he was a believer who had gone there to worship. And the woman bent double in Luke 13 by Satan was delivered from a spirit of infirmity, a demon of infirmity, by Jesus, and she was also in the synagogue. She is a believer because she's called a daughter of Abraham and was said to have been bound by Satan with a spirit of infirmity, which was cast out of her by Jesus. Believers may also be implied in 2 Timothy 2, 23-26, who need to recover themselves from the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. That is, their mind is bound by the devil. A believer in the church at Corinth was doubtless possessed of a spirit of lust, later suffering oppression at the hands of Satan, for the apostle admonishes the church to deliver this member unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. 1 Corinthians 5, verses 1-5. And then Jesus rebuked the fever in Peter's mother-in-law, and she was healed, according to Luke chapter 4. Quite obviously, one does not rebuke a mere rise in temperature, but Jesus was addressing himself here to a malevolent personality, a spirit causing the fever. Jesus uses the same term to rebuke Satan in Mark 8:33 and demons in Mark 9:25 as he does here to rebuke the fever. Now, since the scriptures teach that all sickness is the oppression of Satan, according to Acts 10:38, then it follows that a Christian who becomes sick or diseased is suffering satanic oppression. That statement needs to be repeated again and again, because most Christians have been mistaught and misinformed on this whole question, and they do not believe a Christian can suffer any form of satanic oppression, in spite of the fact that scriptures clearly teach that he can. For example, as we just quoted, Acts 10:38, that passage states this, that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, and he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil. Now, do you suppose he ever healed a believer? Why, of course, he was healing mostly, if not all, believers, those who believed on him. Therefore, if he healed one believer, then a believer can be oppressed of Satan, because we're told there that sickness is an oppression of Satan. Are you a Christian? Have you ever been sick? Then you have been oppressed by Satan. However, you've been taught in your church, that is, most churches teach this, that sickness is from God, and when they get healed, they praise the doctor. Now, I find all of that teaching very strange, because the Bible clearly says that God will heal the sick Christian, and Satan is the one who puts the sickness on them in the first place. Now, if the oppressed are to be set free, we must rid ourselves of the naive and unscriptural notion that believers cannot be oppressed by Satan. We're certainly not suggesting that the believer does not have power over Satan and the works of darkness. He has. But most Christians have the vaguest notions about how to exercise this power. Most do not know how to put their power, their authority, in operation against the powers of darkness. And since most have been taught that sickness is from God, and that the devil was defeated at Calvary in the sense that he can't touch them anymore, then they go around suffering all sorts of oppressions because of these wrong ideas they have. Now, you have authority over Satan, and we'll certainly get to the point in these broadcasts where we show you how to exercise that authority and power by faith over the powers of darkness, but you must first recognize what the Bible has to say on the subject. We're warned to be sober, to be vigilant, for our adversary, the devil, goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, whom resists steadfast in the faith. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Give no place to the devil. So we're warned to be on our guard, because we're told in Ephesians 6, we're in a wrestling match, in a warfare with the powers of darkness. And so if a Christian is automatically set free from oppression when he's saved, then why do not the blind, deaf, and dumb spirits leave upon conversion of that afflicted person? Do you know anyone who's deaf or blind, yet in the church who had that before they were saved? Why, you know they were not automatically set free. If they're set free, it will be by an act of faith on their part, through the prayer of faith by someone in a deliverance ministry. Why do not cancers and other diseases leave, and those oppressed by Satan with these ailments when they converted to Christ? How is it possible for Christians to still be subject to fear, depression, insanity, disease, and pain if believers cannot be oppressed by the powers of darkness? One of the strongest arguments against the unscriptural contention that Satan presents no serious threat to the believer is given by the Apostle Paul himself in 2 Corinthians 12, in which he states that he himself suffered oppression at the hands of a messenger of Satan who was allowed to buffet him. He tells us in 1 Thessalonians that Satan hindered him. Now, there are two dangerous and unscriptural attitudes towards Satan and his demonic forces. One is to deny, as the liberal churches do, the reality and existence of a personal adversary called the devil. On the other hand, it's absurd to do as most contemporary Christians do and treat the subject with an attitude of indifference, being blind to his extensive power and work, and being deluded by the naive notion that Satan presents no real threat to the believer beyond tempting one to sin now and then. The New Testament is filled with warnings which admonish the believer to resist the devil, to put on the whole armor of God, that they may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, saying, "We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." No, the scriptures abound in references to a spiritual conflict which the believer is to take seriously against an evil, cunning, powerful adversary who rules over a vast, highly organized kingdom consisting of these principalities and powers and world rulers of the darkness of this age. He's designated as the prince of the power of the air, the ruler of this world, the god of this age. These are not titles or designations that I have given him, but these are the titles that God himself and his word has given to Satan. And so let's be realistic in this matter. And to see the foolishness of the unscriptural notion that Satan presents no serious threat to the believer, one needs only to recall some of the instances given in Scripture itself of Satan's victory in the lives of the unwary and the careless, as for example in the fall of Adam and Eve from their sinless state of perfection into sin and disobedience, the yielding of King Saul to an evil spirit and his tragic end, the sin of David and its consequences, the betrayal of Judas, one of the 12 apostles, the denial of Christ by Peter himself, who was also an apostle, and the influence of Satan in the lives of Ananias and Sapphira, two of the first disciples in the early church. Then we see the incestuous sin in the life of a member in the Corinthian church, according to 1 Corinthians 5. The desertion of Paul by Demas, a fellow worker of the apostle who returned to the world, giving up Christianity. The excommunication of Hymenaeus and Alexander in consequence of their loss of the true faith, as well as the sins and low moral and spiritual state of several of the first century Christian churches mentioned in the book of Revelation, which necessitated a sharp rebuke by Christ himself. Added to that, we could say the scriptures plainly forewarn believers there will be some who will be influenced by Satan, being drawn away by his deceptions. For we're told in 1 Timothy 4:1, the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter days some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and the doctrines of demons. Now it ought to be obvious to you, my friends, that you cannot depart from the Christian faith unless you're first in the Christian faith. He said in the latter days many would depart from the Christian faith because they give heed to seducing spirits and the doctrines of demons. One writer said in the deliverance ministry that most of the people that he had prayed for had been members of Christian churches. Now if you want a detailed study on this subject and how to be set free from the oppression of the powers of darkness, send for the book and tape list and get the book entitled Angels of Light, or the book Every Wind of Doctrine, and it will show you the reality of the things that we're talking about in these broadcasts, and in the next message on this station, we're going to show you how to get free and stay free.